Matthew 21, Jesus said in verse 21, "Verily I say unto you, if you have faith and doubt not, ye shall not only do this which is done to the fig tree." And we didn't read the context, but he had told a fig tree that no one would eat from it again. In fact, in verse 19, he said, "Let no fruit grow on thee henceforward forever." And presently the fig tree withered away. And he just simply talked to it. Some people would be embarrassed to do that. They don't want to talk to a tree, but yet they'll talk to their car and call it a piece of junk. Well, that car heard that. But he talked to the tree, and the tree obeyed him. No man, well, Mark chapter 11 says it a little differently. Matthew 21, 19, "Let no fruit grow in thee henceforward forever." And it withered away. And the disciples marveled when they saw it, saying, "How soon is the fig tree withered away?" Well, Jesus responded to that and said, "If you have faith and doubt not, you shall not only do this." So he's saying to them, you could have done this. In Mark 11, it's a little different. Same occurrence, same story, but Mark just puts it in different words. But in Mark 11, Jesus said, "No man eat fruit of thee henceforward or hereafter forever." That's Mark 11, 14. And Peter, verse 21, "The next morning they saw the fig tree dried up from the roots." And Peter, in verse 21, Mark 11, 21, "calling to remembrance, saith unto him, Master, behold, the fig tree which you cursed is withered away. And Jesus answering saith unto them," now this is Mark 11, 23, or verse 22, "have faith in God." Now the margin of my Bible, there's a little two, a number two there, which takes me to the margin. And where he said, "have faith in God," the margin of my Bible says he actually said, or the Greek says, "have the faith of God." Now, I believe that's important. Jesus cursed the fig tree. That's how it's written in Mark chapter 11. He cursed the fig tree. Or he spoke death. He spoke words to the fig tree that caused it to die. And Peter said in verse 21, "Behold, the fig tree which you cursed is withered away." Or you spoke to it words that caused it to die. What caused the fig tree to die? Jesus' words. And yet people don't want to do that. They feel awkward, or they feel weird, or they feel, you know, that's strange. And yet, yeah, they'll kick the tire and call their car a piece of junk, or throw down a tool, or kick a machine and say, you no good, you know, piece of junk. And then when something happens in their life or in their body, I tell people frequently, if you have something going on in your body, sickness and disease, talk to it. I've talked to doctors and nurses, and I've just asked. They don't teach that in medical school, do they? You know, they'll treat disease, sickness and disease, with surgery and procedure and medicine. This pill, that lotion. But in medical school, they don't teach talk to it. Now, those other things get results sometimes. We're all fighting the same enemy. Sickness and disease is an enemy. And yeah, you can take that pill and it has side effects and you're actually worse. But I tell people, the doctor says you have cancer in your body, talk to it. "Cancer, I command you to die. I command you to leave my body." Or whatever it is. And somebody said, "Well, my head hurts." Well, talk to it. "I've got a headache." Talk to it. "Well, I feel like I'm coming down with a cold." Well, talk to it. And see, that's strange to some people. And yet Jesus said, If you had faith and didn't doubt, you'd not only do this, which is done to the fig tree, but Matthew 21, he said, you'd talk to the mountain, remove hence to yonder place. Mark 11, for verily I say unto you that whosoever shall say unto this mountain. Now we have people saying God is able to move your mountain. And yet it doesn't say for you to pray about it. It doesn't even say God will move it. I'm quite certain it's his power that's behind it. I'm quite certain it's his power. The faith of God. Now that's important. The faith of God. Have the faith of God. If you go back to Genesis chapter 1, everything that God created, he created with words. In Genesis chapter 1, he spoke. He said, let there be. And there was. He spoke. And God said, in Genesis chapter 1, several of the verses there begin with the phrase, and God said, and God said, and God said, and God said. And then you come down to the very last verse of Genesis chapter 1, and it says, and God saw. Before he saw, he said. And then Jesus said, have the faith of God. Now see, that's important. The devil knows this works in Proverbs, actually. Chapter 18 and verse 21, it says death and life are in the power of the tongue. Death's mentioned first. And it's all in the power of the tongue. Death and life are in the power of the tongue. The devil knows that. That's why he tries to get the church to not say very much, but to put everything off on God and always pray. Prayer's important, all right, but you know, Jesus didn't say, pray about the mountain. God, take this mountain away from me. God, move this mountain for me. Prayer's important in its place, but you can pray wrong. Can somebody say amen? Jesus, you know, we need to do it the way Jesus said to do it. He didn't say, now when you see a big mighty mountain, pray about it. He didn't say that. But we have people praying about the mountain. And yet that's not what he said. He said, speak to it. Well, I'm praying God heal me of cancer. Well, that's all right. But are you talking to it? Are you talking to it? Well, I'm praying God take away the pain. Well, there's a place for that kind of prayer in line with Scripture. But are you talking to it? That's really what Jesus said to do. Amen. Well, I'm just waiting on God to do it. Well, he may just be waiting on you to do it. Hosea chapter 4 and verse 6, this is Old Testament, but it's a powerful Scripture. Hosea chapter 4, verse 6 is my people, and it's God talking through the prophet, my people are destroyed for a lack of knowledge. God's people, not the devil's people. It doesn't even say backslidden people. My people are destroyed. Now, why are they destroyed? Why are God's people destroyed? Good, sweet people who love the Lord are defeated in life. They're just, you know, from pillar to post. They're just barely making it, you know, just barely getting by. Amen. And they love the Lord. And yet they live defeated lives, praying, hoping to God that he'll see fit to do something for them. Barely getting along. You know, tempted to grumble every day. Tempted to complain. Bellyache, because they're just barely making it, and they don't understand God, you know, is letting this happen to me. God's, you know, humbling me, or God's trying to teach me. Well, he may be trying to teach you, and maybe he wants you to learn. And so many people, I meet them, they love the Lord. They're sweet people. They love you. You love them. They're good, sweet people, precious hearts who love the Lord. And yet they live defeated lives. And they somehow believe God's got some plan for it. God's got some purpose for it. Overall, they sometimes have a good attitude. Well, God's letting me live this way. He has some purpose, some plan. And yet they're living beneath their rights and privileges. And Hosea chapter 4, verse 6 tells us why. Chapter 4, verse 6 says, my people are destroyed for a lack of knowledge. Well, if you don't know what God said, you certainly can't do it. If you've never really heard it taught and emphasized, you can read over that verse and not really get the meaning. Jesus said, speak to the mountain. And if you've never really done that, first time you hear it taught, first time you begin to do it, feels strange. I'm talking to the pain and telling it to go. In Jesus' name. And then you can remind it. Jesus only cursed the fig tree one time. It's like a seed. You only plant the seed one time, but you'll weed it and water it. And so I sometimes talk to something again and again, but I tell it, you've been cursed. You can't stay in Jesus' name. And if you'll be diligent to do that and stay with it, everybody say, stay with it. Jesus said it would obey you. Jesus said it would obey you. Now, it's very specific in Luke 17, 6. Luke 17, 6 speaks of a sycamine tree. It's very specific. Jesus said in Luke 17, 6, if you had faith as a mustard seed, and seeds are planted, that is, it's progressive. Jesus said, if you had faith as a mustard seed or as a seed, just any kind of seed, a mustard seed is small. And faith can start small. But you plant it. It doesn't matter how small it is. Even a small seed, when planted, will produce. And a mustard seed's a small seed. In fact, in that area, in that culture, it was the smallest seed that produced a tree that they were familiar with, that they dealt with on, you know, daily or on a usual basis. And he said, if you had faith just like that, it's just like talking to that sycamine tree and telling it to be plucked up by the root. Now, that's important. Let's just analyze this. By the root is the unseen realm. Faith is of the unseen realm. We have to believe things we don't see. Can I have an amen? I don't see the root system, but I'm believing it's cursed. Plucked up by the root and planted in the sea. Jesus said in Luke 17, 6, that tree would obey you. Well, I'm just believing God's going to move that tree. Well, I'm quite sure his is the power behind it, but he told you to do it. He told you to talk to it. He said it would obey you. He didn't say it would obey God. Well, I'm praying God is going to move my mountain. Well, again, I'm quite sure it's his power, but he didn't say he was going to move it. He told you to. Now, this is strange in some circles. Yeah, they think that person's talking to things is crazy. He's out there talking to trees. He's crazy. He's talking to his body. He's talking to the pain. He's talking to the devil. Now, in the world, some places they think you're strange if you're talking to the Lord. But they really, you go some churches and they think you're strange if you're talking to the devil. And yet Jesus said, in my name, cast out devils. And Jesus again and again would talk to he would talk to his Father in prayer. He would talk to things. He would talk to devils. He would talk to bodies. He would talk to sickness. And he would command it to obey. Sickness, he would command it to obey. Devils, he would command them to obey. Amen. Isn't that right? And then he told us to do it. He said, in my name, you'll do this. Well, back to Matthew 21. If you have faith and doubt not, now that's really the key. And that's where people miss it. Even the people who begin to do this, when they don't get results, it's because they doubted. If everything was instant, you wouldn't have the opportunity to doubt. So some things are not instant. Can you say amen? You'll have the opportunity to doubt when you talk to the mountain, and after you've finished speaking, you look and see it's still there. Now you've got the opportunity to doubt. Or you talk to the fig tree, and after you finish speaking, you look and it's still there. Now the root system you don't see. You can't see in the unseen realm that it's already dead. When Jesus cursed the fig tree, it dried up from the roots. But just to look at the tree, it still looked alive. In Matthew 21, we don't see it as clearly. But in Mark 11, it's the next day, the next morning, that Peter, calling him to remembrance, and said, Master, behold, the fig tree which you cursed is withered away. In Matthew 21, it does say in verse 18, in the morning, as he returned into the city, he hungered and he saw a fig tree in the way and came to it and found there nothing thereon. He spoke to it. But see, it's the next morning when they saw that it was withered. You see that clearer in Mark. So it's the next morning. Therefore, when Jesus spoke to it, when he was finished speaking, you look at it, it doesn't look dead. Are you following me? The fig tree dried up from the roots. Do you understand that? The roots were dead. Some people have live Christmas trees in their house. Well, those trees look alive. We know they're dead because it's in somebody's house. But it looks alive. You take that same tree, an evergreen, you know, and you cut it down, maybe real close to the ground, and then dig a hole and put that tree in the hole and stabilize it, support it, give it a good support foundation somehow. And then if people won't inspect the roots, because there are no roots, it's cut, it's separated. If all they do is look at the tree and the limbs and the, you know, the evergreen needles, they'll think it's alive. Even the professional, the horticulturist, you could fool him if he doesn't look at the roots. The roots are in the unseen realm. When I curse something in Jesus' name, it's dead in the unseen realm. Now I've got the opportunity to doubt because in the seen realm, it still looks alive. I may still see it. I may still feel it. But yet, if I have faith and doubt not, it's going to wither. Why will it wither? Because in the root system, it's dead. It's lost its life source. It's going to wither. It's going to change from this point forward. We're going the right direction. So Jesus said, if you had faith and doubt not, you'll not only do this, which is done to the fig tree, but also if you say to the mountain, be thou removed and be thou cast into the sea, it shall be done. Everybody say it shall be. So if I talk to the sickness, if I talk to the disease, if I talk to the fig tree, if I talk to the mountain, if I talk to the sycamine tree, in Jesus' name, and I have faith and I don't doubt, from that point forward, I'm believing now it shall be done. I don't need to curse it again, but I can tell it, you've been cursed. You cannot stay. It shall be done. Everybody say it shall be done. And I can thank God for that. From this point forward, I'm praising God. Well, I'm praying God move my mountain. Why don't you praise God that it shall be done? If you've talked to it. Well, I've prayed about it, Brother Tony. I sure have done a lot of praying. And that's one reason good, sweet people who love the Lord are defeated in life. is they're not doing what Jesus said to do. He didn't say do a lot of praying about that mountain. I mean, you can read it again and again and again. Nowhere in this context did Jesus say, pray about that fig tree. Pray about that mountain. In Luke 17, 6, he didn't say, pray about that sycamine tree. And yet I go, you know, around different Christians and churches. I'm around different people, aren't you? I read after them, I hear them talk, and they're praying about it. Well, I'm sure praying. I know God can. Have you ever heard anybody say, God can move that mountain? God can do it. And some preacher will get excited about God can, and he'll get worked up and excited and from the pulpit, you know, shouting, God can move your mountain. And I've been to churches where they just get excited about that and shout and dance and run around the church singing about it and shouting about it. God can move my mountain. But a year later, they've still got that mountain. You know, 2 years later, 3 years later, if it's some debilitating disease, they're worse. Somebody say amen. And yet they were excited. God can move that mountain. You see, you're not doing it the way Jesus said to do it. He did not say, pray about that mountain. Did he? Did he say, pray about that sycamine tree? Did he? Did he say, pray about the fig tree? Did he? No, he said for you to talk to it. He said, if you had faith and doubt not, you'll not only do this, which I did. Now, what did he do to the fig tree? Did he pray about it? He didn't pray about it, did he? He just said, Matthew put it, let no fruit grow on thee henceforward forever. And he just said it. That's all he did. Some things you don't need to pray if you just go ahead and say. Amen. Now, if you're going to pray, make sure your praying is in line with your saying. But some things you don't need to pray. You can just say. Amen. And he just simply said, let no fruit grow on thee henceforward forever. And the fig tree withered away. And he said, you could do this. Well, I can do what you did. What did you do? Let's go over it again. I spoke to the tree. And did you notice I didn't pray about it? I just simply spoke to it. And it withered away. And you could have done this. And not only this, but you can talk to the mountain. Now that's Matthew 21. Go back to Mark 11 and look at it a little closer in Mark 11. Jesus said in verse 23, whosoever, does that include you? If you believe it, say out loud, I'm a whosoever. Whosoever meaneth me. Not a preacher, not an apostle, prophet, evangelist, pastor, or teacher, but whosoever. Mark 11, 23, whosoever shall say unto this mountain, be thou removed and be thou cast into the sea and shall not doubt in his heart. Well, then that's where people miss it. That'd be the number one place to look. If I'm not getting results, it's because I'm doubting in my heart. I mean, if I've spoken, if I've said something to the mountain, if I've told the mountain to be removed and to be cast into the sea, and I'm not getting results, I'm doubting in my heart. For Jesus said, if I would say to the mountain, be cast into the sea and not doubt in my heart, but believe, and he means in your heart, not your head. Your head may agree. He wants you to believe in your heart that what you say will come to pass. What does he ask you to believe? What does he say you must believe? You must believe that what you're saying is going to come to pass. And then don't doubt it in your heart. Your head may fight you. I've learned something important. You can doubt in your head and still have faith in your heart. and it'll work for you. Your head can fight you. Your head can wonder why. But if you'll keep acting on what you believe in your heart, keep saying what you believe in your heart, it'll work for you. Because he said, if you believe what you say will come to pass and you're not doubting in your heart, you'll have whatever you say. Now, he said you'd have what you say. Now, I'm going to get to verse 24 in a moment, and then we'll come back to Matthew 21 to look at that, how Matthew puts it. Because verse 24 mentions praying, but verse 23 does not. Verse 23 mentions saying. Now, I just said it. Let me ask you what I said. Verse 23 mentions what? Saying. Verse 24 mentions what? Praying. So we need to read both verses, because verse 23 does not mention praying, but it does mention saying. And verse 24 mentions praying. So how I pray is important, but verse 23 does not mention praying at all, but it does mention saying. So there are some things you don't even need to pray as long as you believe what you say. See, Jesus didn't pray about the fig tree. And I get around Christians again, Hosea 4:6, my people are destroyed because they've never heard this. Or if they did hear it, they didn't believe it. My people are destroyed for a lack of knowledge. People all over the Christian world are praying and praying and praying. Well, other religions, they're praying. Every religion of the world that I know anything about believes in some form of prayer. And even people who are not saved in the world, they believe, unless they're atheist or agnostic, even sinners pray. They believe in some form of prayer. They'll come ask you for prayer when they get in trouble. They don't want to serve God. But if they're in trouble, they'll ask you to pray. Is that right? Is that right? So they believe in prayer. Very often, though, these kinds of prayers are not answered. Why? Because my people are destroyed for a lack of knowledge. It's not what the Bible tells us to do. We're praying about things he didn't even say pray about. Or we're praying in a way that's really doubt and unbelief. God doesn't answer prayers of doubt and unbelief. And praying when we're not really wanting to serve him anyway, or it's not in line with his word. But these are the areas where he didn't say pray at all. Jesus didn't pray about the mountain. Now, the fellowship that I have is different. Prayer is fellowship. If I'm about to speak to the mountain, I might pray as a form of fellowship and tell the Lord what I'm about to do. I'm praying, all right. In my prayer, I might say, Lord, you see that mountain? I know you see it. I do too. I know you know it's there. I do too. And I'll tell you what I'm going to do about it, Lord. I'm going to do just what you said to do. I'm going to speak to it. Now, see, I'm praying, but I'm not praying for him to move it. In my prayer, I'm telling him I'm going to move it. Now, it's your power. Don't misunderstand. You're not doing it in your own power. But I can say, Lord, I'm going to talk to that mountain because you told me to. I'm going to use the name of Jesus because you told me to. And I expect it to go. I expect it to obey me because you said it would. Now, see, the sycamine tree is clear. Luke 17:6, it's clear. Jesus said, it will obey you. If you have faith as a grain of mustard seed, you'll say to this sycamine tree, be plucked up by the root. That, again, that's the unseen realm, root, and planted in the sea. That is, it's gone from you. Like the sea of forgetfulness. It's so far gone, you can forget about it now. He said, it'll happen. It'll obey you. Who did he say it would obey? You. Luke 17:6, it's clear. Well, if the sycamine tree obeys you, the fig tree, the mountain, it's you, it's obeying. Jesus didn't pray about it. He spoke to it. No man is going to eat fruit on thee hereafter forever. Let no fruit grow on you henceforward forever. Matthew says it a little differently than Mark, but it's the same thing. He's saying it, you're not going to have fruit again forever. And he just spoke to it, and it obeyed his words. He didn't pray about it. Now again, in prayer, he might have said, Father, I'm about to speak to that tree. And I can do that too. I can say, Lord, I'm about to speak to that. Now that's prayer. But the prayer is not talking to God for God to do it as much as I'm telling the Lord, I'm going to do it. And you don't even have to do that, but you can if you want to. He simply said, talk to it, speak to it, command it to go. And he said it would obey you. And if you'll have faith and doubt not, that is, if you'll believe in your heart, don't doubt in your heart, but believe that what you say will come to pass, then you'll have it. He'll have whatsoever he saith. Verse 23, the last phrase, he shall have whatsoever he saith. He shall have whatsoever he saith. Verse 23, the last phrase, he shall have whatsoever he prayeth. No, whatsoever he saith. Now let's look at it. Did you notice in verse 23, whosoever shall say unto this mountain, says there, be removed and cast into the sea, and shall not doubt in his heart, but believe that those things which he saith, there that is the second time, shall come to pass. He shall have whatsoever he saith, there it is the third time. Do you see that say and saith is in there three times? It's in there three times. Believe is in there once, and doubt is in there once. It's interesting to me that saying is in there more times than believing is. Saying is in there more times than believing is. In order to believe it, you're going to have to say it. And if you go by that, saying is in there more times than believing, you may have to say it a lot before you believe it. And then if you've not been taught this, and it's awkward and it's strange and it's weird, and yet even those people that think it's weird, if I'm around them long enough, I see them talking to things. And it's almost always negative. They don't go out to their car and pat the fender and say, you're just wonderful. Good car. But if something happens, it won't crank, the battery's dead, or they've got a flat tire, then they kick it and they say, you piece of junk. It's almost always negative. You think the devil's behind that? If he knows words are powerful, he doesn't want you to speak positive words of faith that are productive for victory, but he sure doesn't mind you speaking destructive words that destroy and damage. He's got our vocabulary filled with destructive words even when they don't make any sense. It does not make any sense to laugh to death. I laughed until I thought I'd die. Well, you ought to laugh until you thought you'd live forever. Tickled to death. Well, somebody said, no, I just felt like I couldn't breathe. I'm about to die. All right, you're trying to reason that one away. Explain this one to me. How can you love somebody to death? Tell me how that makes sense at all. I just love him to death. Well, I'd rather you didn't. Don't love me to death, please. No, what I mean is I'm going to love them till they die. Yeah, really, is that what you mean? You hadn't even thought about it. It's in the vocabulary. We've got fear in the vocabulary. It's a byword. Are you going to go to the meeting? No, I'm afraid not. Why are you afraid? But fear is powerful, and the devil's brought it into the vocabulary where people in the world and in the church are saying these powerful words without even thinking. I'm tickled to death. That thrills me to death. I tell you, Jesus said you can have what you say. If you believe the things that you say will come to pass, you'll have what you say. If he appeared to somebody and said, from this day forward, whatever you say will come to pass, that person might say, oh my, that thrills me to death. And just fall over dead. because Jesus said they can have what they say. And when they got a hold of it, they said, wow, look at that. I can have what I say. That just thrills me to death. Clunk. That's one reason things don't work. He's removed some of the power of our words because it would destroy us. If you get back over on the positive side, then you'll begin to enjoy more of the power of the words. If you'll discipline yourself to stop saying negative things. Well, I believe I'm taking a cold. Well, stop believing that. If you keep believing that, you'll take it. Well, I believe I'm coming down with the flu. Well, you can have it if you believe it. Jesus said you can have it if you believe it. Well, you know, cancer runs in my family. I believe I'll get it. Well, if you keep believing that, you will. And if it runs in your family, you ought to change families, get born again, and have a new father and a new family. What runs in my family is healing, health, life, and strength, victory, redemption, forgiveness. Not only forgiveness, but the washing away of sin. That's what runs in my family, life. Amen. I've got a father who's in heaven, and I've got a divine nature that's by the precious spirit of Christ, and I'm in the family of God. Amen. I could just spend a while tell you what runs in my family. And when I was born again, I was translated from death into life. I was changed. Glory to God. All things are new. Old things have passed away. And Galatians 3:13 says, Christ has redeemed us from the curse of the law, being made a curse for us. For cursed is everyone that hangeth upon a tree, that the blessing of Abraham might come on the Gentiles through Jesus Christ. So he bore my curse. He became my curse. I'm not under any curse. Somebody said, well, those generational curses, you know, you've got to break those. Jesus already did. I don't have to break a one of them. He already did. Amen. But somebody said, I just believe I'm going to get cancer. Well, you keep believing that, you will, and you need to stop believing that. Why don't you start believing by whose stripes I was healed? Well, the doctor says I have that. Don't believe everything the doctor says. Believe what the Bible says. And if it's in your body, talk to it. Say is in there three times. Say and saith is in there three times. Believe is in there once. Doubt is in there once. Seems to me that's there by design. We'll have to do more saying to get to the place where we are believing and not doubting. Keep saying it. If you believe the things which you say will come to pass, you'll have what you say. And what did you say? Your saying wasn't to God. That would be praying. That's the next verse. This verse isn't mentioning praying. It's mentioning saying. And your saying isn't to God. That would be praying. Your saying is to the problem. And pat your car on the fender and say it's a good car if you want to. That certainly makes more sense than kicking the car tire and calling it a piece of junk. You old rattle trap. That's right. If you're going to talk to it, talk good. Talk blessing. Talk blessing. Amen. But if something's in my body, I don't want there. I talk to it. The doctor says it's there. Or I can see it or feel it. No, I command you to go in Jesus' name. And that's what Jesus said to do. Well, I'm praying God heal me. He didn't say do that. I mean, dear sweet Christian after Christian after Christian after Christian has gone on to be with the Lord. Thank God they went to heaven. I'm glad they went to heaven. I'm headed there that myself, and there's some days I'd just soon go on. And they're there before me, and they're rejoicing. Thank God they're rejoicing. Can you say, thank God they're rejoicing? The Bible says to die is gain. To depart and be with Christ is far better. So it's better. When we have loved ones that have gone on, we can rejoice with them. Is that right? Amen. But one reason is we didn't do what he told us to do. Maybe we didn't know. We weren't taught, or we doubted. We weren't continually built up, and that's fine. I mean, I'd rather go to heaven where there's gain and far better. Amen. But it's also good to talk to that cancer, talk to that disease. Jesus said, you'd obey me. And if we've not been taught that, we can't do that. Or if we've not been taught it enough, or we're not doing it enough, because say is in there three times. Sometimes people say it, they're just trying it. They've not really been taught it. They've heard about it. Well, I think I'll try that. I heard to do that, so I'm going to do that too. But it's not really enough. They're not really built up. And the believing isn't in their heart, it's in their head. And the doubting is in their heart. And they're not really believing that what they're saying is working because of how they feel and what they see. You can't be moved by what you see. You can't be moved by what you feel. You've got to be moved by what you believe. Amen? Cancer, you can't stay in my body. Or if it tries to come back, no, you're not coming back on me. Now, Janice was healed of leukemia. No room for it. You can't come back on me. I refuse to accept you. We're going to mark this package RTS. I'm not accepting it. Maybe UPS left it on my porch, but I'm not taking it. I'm not unwrapping it. I'm not taking it out of the box. I'm marking that RTS, and I'm taking it right back to the UPS center or calling them, telling them, come get it. I'm not accepting that package. Devil, I'm not taking it. Maybe you've put it on my front door, but I'm not taking it. It's not coming into my house, or if it comes in, it's just temporary. I'm not unpacking it. I'm not unboxing it because I'm not accepting it. The devil will put some things on you, and you can just simply say, no, you don't. I'm not accepting you in Jesus' name. Now, that saying, I'm saying to the sycamine tree, Jesus said it would obey me. Everybody say, Jesus said it would obey me. I'm saying to the mountain. I'm saying to the fig tree. Now, verse 24 is a praying scripture. Verse 23 is a saying scripture. Praying's not mentioned. Verse 24 is a praying scripture. Therefore, I say unto you, what things soever you desire, when you pray, believe that you receive them, and ye shall have them. When did he say to believe? When you pray. Did he say to believe when you have it? No, he said, because you believe, you will have it. The having goes with the believing. I believe I have it now. I have to believe that. If I'm waiting to see it before I believe it, I never will see it. If I'm waiting to feel it before I believe it, I never will feel it. Because he said, when you pray, believe, and you'll have it. I must believe I have it in the spirit realm. You understand? Before I see it, we walk by faith, not by sight. I must believe I have something that I don't see. I must believe that I have something that I don't feel. And Jesus said, you'll have it. When you pray, believe. Well, Brother Tony, I'm going to believe it when I see it. You'll never will see it. That's not what he said to do. Well, I just know one day God's going to heal me. That's not what he said to do. I just know one day he's going to take this disease away from me. He's going to take this habit away from me. I've been praying for God to take it. I'm thinking about a lady right now who was asking God to take the snuff away from her. God, take this snuff. Well, what's he going to do with it? God don't dip snuff. He's not going to take it. He told you to lay it aside. He told you to put it down. He didn't say to pray he'd take it. Lord, I want you to take this filthy habit from me. Well, if he could take it, what would he do with it? That's right. Amen. He doesn't dip, pinch, or chew. Amen. That's right. No, we're the custodians over our body. We have to dominate our flesh. But people are praying for God to take things. Take this sickness. Take this disease. Take this habit. He didn't say that to pray that way. He said, when you pray, believe that you receive. Well, I have deliverance. I have freedom. I have healing. I have the answer now. I believe right now while I'm praying that I receive the answer. Amen. Now, when you say it, you don't necessarily need to pray it, because in verse 23, he didn't mention praying. You can just say it. I'm just saying. Like when Jesus raised Lazarus from the dead, when he heard about it, he said, this sickness is not unto death. In John chapter 11, they told him, you know, your friend that you love is sick, dying. And Jesus simply said, this sickness is not unto death. That sickness didn't end in death. He died, but that's not the end. That's important, because Jesus said, this sickness is not unto death, meaning this sickness will not end in death. He died. Now, eventually he died and stayed dead, but not of that sickness. He died, but that wasn't the end. He said, this sickness will not end in death, but this sickness will end with the glory of God. That's John chapter 11. Now, see, he said it. He didn't pray it. He said it. He said it. He said it. This sickness, your friend, the friend who you love, is sick and dying. And he said, this sickness is not unto death. Meaning, this sickness will not end with death. Well, later he died, but Jesus could say, that's not the end. You've not seen the end yet. I said this sickness will not end in death. What did I say it would end with? I said it would end with glory. And the only way it's going to end with glory if he's raised from the dead. And he was. Can somebody say amen? He was raised from the dead. Now at the gravesite, Jesus did pray. Father, thank you that you heard me. And I know you hear me always. But because of the people, you know, that are gathered together and around me, that's why I'm praying this now, so they can believe. Thank you that you heard me. Now, this is important. Susan's looking for it, the actual verse. You want me to find it? When he said, thank you that you heard me, what do you think he's talking about? Verse 41, thank you that you heard me. What's he talking about? He's talking about when he said in verse 4, this sickness is not unto death. Well, the sickness will not end in death. He may die, but that's not the end. And he did die, but that's not the end. No, this sickness will not end in death. This sickness will end with the glory of God, that the Son of God might be glorified thereby. And he brought glory. That sickness ended in glory. Well, how did that happen? When he's raised from the dead. Now, eventually, Lazarus died again. He's not on the earth yet today. We don't know when and how, but he died again. But he didn't die of that sickness, did he? But see, here's the thing. When Jesus heard, they said to him, he whom thou lovest is sick, in verse 3. When he heard that, he simply said. There are some things, if you're bold in your faith, now it's God listening. He said, I thank you that you heard me. God's listening to what you say. If you know you're in fellowship with him and you know he's listening and what you're saying is in line with his word and his will and his spirit, some things you don't even need to pray. You just say. Just say. He's hearing you. You're in fellowship with him. There's an air of prayer about you. But some things you don't even need to pray. You just say, I command the pain to go in Jesus' name. I command my shoulder to be normal in Jesus' name. Whatever, something along those lines. You just say it. And then you can pray, Father, thank you. Because he said it in verse 4. He didn't pray it. He said it. But in verse 41, now he's praying. And what he's praying now in verse 41 is, Father, I thank you. You heard me. Heard me? Heard me when? What's he talking about? Back when he said, this sickness is not unto death. Father, you heard me say that. You're the power behind it. You heard me say it. And really, the only reason I'm praying it now this way is because of the people that are around me, the people which stand by, so that they may believe that thou hast sent me. Now, Mark 11:23, you say to the mountain, say to the sickness, say to cancer, say to pain, say to lack. Get your checkbook out and talk to it. Get your bank account out and talk to it. Say to inanimate objects, money, pain, disease. Mark 11:23 is saying. Some things you don't need to pray, you just need to say. But in Mark 11:24, when you do pray, then you still have to say it. Your saying has to be in line with your praying. When you leave that place of prayer, you're either going to undergird or undo what you just prayed by what you say. When you leave that place of prayer, now it's important what you say. If you've believed that you've received, you'll say things in line with that. So if you pray it, you still have to say it. But if you say it, you don't have to pray it. If you say it, you don't have to pray it. But if you pray it, you still have to say it. Can you understand that? Some things you don't have to pray, but you do have to say. But if you do pray, you still have to say. When you leave that place of prayer, what you say is important. Jesus said it. Then when he prayed in line with what he said. Well, if you're going to pray, you'll have to pray in line with what you said. And then if you pray first, then later what you say is going to have to be in line with what you prayed. Or you can undo it. Now, go back to Matthew 21, how we started. Let's end how we started. Matthew 21, verse 22 now. And all things whatsoever ye shall ask in prayer. Now, if he just stopped right there, we'd have it made. If he left out the word believing, we'd have it made. Take out that word believing and read it without the word believing. All things whatsoever you shall ask in prayer, you shall receive. If that's what he said, we just, whatever we pray, we'd have it. But he didn't say it that way. He put that word believing in there. Yeah, that's right. Some things that people pray, they really ought not have. Believing, now that means believing God, not something that you're thinking up on your own. You can't believe God unless you know the word of God. You can't believe me unless you've heard my word. How can you believe me if you've not heard me? Well, I'm believing Brother Tony is going to give me $1,000. Well, you can believe that all you want, but until you hear me say it, you're not believing me. You can pass a rumor around. You know, everybody that comes to the service, Brother Tony's going to give $1,000 to. I tell you, if people believe that, this place would be full. And they can come here and say, I'm here to get my $1,000. They're believing it. But see, they didn't hear me say it. So when this says believing, it doesn't mean just believing a rumor. It doesn't mean just believing something you've thought up. Or somebody else has thought up and told you to pray. No, it's when you know the word of God yourself. You've heard his word and you believe it. Well, now pray in line with that. Whatsoever you shall ask for in prayer, believing, that is, you've got God's word on it. You've heard his word. It's his promise to you. It's his provision for you. It's his word given to you. then you can pray about it. You can believe that you receive it. When you pray, you'll have it. Says it differently in Mark 11:24. Matthew 21:22 says you'll receive it. Mark 11:24 says you'll have it. Both places, though, is you believe when you pray. And then you believe in God. You've heard his word. So, Lord, this is what you've said in your word. This is what I can read. This is what I've heard. It's right here in your word. I right now pray for this. And right now, I believe I receive it. Father, I right now thank you for it. And when I come up from this place of prayer, if you're kneeling and you rise up on your feet, leaving that place of prayer, you go your way. Now you're thanking God. I have believed, I have received, and Jesus said I'd have it. And that's what I'm saying. That's what I'm saying. I'm going to have it because Jesus said so. I've received it. I'm believing his word. I've prayed in line with his word. Now, you didn't have to pray. You could have just said. But if you're going to pray, then your saying has to line up with it. Amen. Is that confusing or does it make sense? I believe, I receive. Now, it's really up to me. It's up to me. Well, I'm just turning it all over to the Lord. The devil loves that. Because so many people believe they're turning something over to the Lord when really, by default, they're turning it over to the devil. Because if you've got a responsibility and you don't do it, the devil will do it for you. Amen. That's right. But if you decide and you see and you've understood, he's told me to believe it. He's told me to say it. He's told me to pray it. And that's what I'm going to do. I'm going to do what he said to do. I'm going to speak to it. I'm going to pray about it, but I'm going to believe that I receive when I pray. And then go my way saying, thank God it's done. I have it now. I have it now. See, the fig tree looked alive, but Jesus had spoken to it. Thank God I have it now. You'll see it. You don't see it right now. I don't need to see it. I believe it. It was the next day, Peter calling him to remembrance said, Master, behold, the fig tree which you cursed is withered away. Jesus didn't say, well, my, look at that. It is. Wow, this works. He didn't get excited about it. He believed it the day before. He believed it when he didn't see it. They didn't believe it until they saw it. So many Christians today won't believe until they see it. And that's the reason they don't have it, not going to have it. Amen. So I have it now in the spirit realm. It's been spoken to. It's been cursed. I spoke to it in Jesus' name. And Jesus said it would obey me. You just look at that mountain. Jesus said you'd obey me. Look at that sycamine tree. Jesus said you'd obey me. You can't stay. I've left the place of prayer. I believe that I received. And I have the glad note of thanksgiving. It's done. It's working. Everybody say it's done. It's working in Jesus' name. Do you see it working? I don't see a thing, but it's working. Has it changed? I don't see anything, but it's working. Thank God it's working. And you go to the Lord in prayer, prayers of praise. Can you say amen? Amen. Now, my people are destroyed for a lack of knowledge. Once you get this knowledge, you're not destroyed anymore. You don't walk in defeat, you walk in victory. This is the victory that overcomes the world, even our faith. Not our fear, not our despair, but the victory that overcomes the world, John said, is our faith. And the shield of faith quenches the fiery darts, and speaking words of faith bring victory. Amen. Said out loud, I have victory. I have healing. I have health. God supplies every need according to his riches and glory. In the name of Jesus, the sycamine tree obeys me. Say that out loud. The sycamine tree obeys me. The fig tree obeys me. the mountain obeys me in the name of Jesus.